78 in the prayer book. Thus says the high and lofty one who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place, and also with the one who has a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite. On page 79. Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to set forth his praise, to hear his holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation, and so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship him. Let us kneel in silence and with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. Together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways for the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Our opening hymn in the hymnal, the hymn number is 679. 679. The title of the hymn is Surely It Is God Who Saves Me. Again, number 679.
Bow down your ear, O Lord, and answer me,
for I am poor and in misery.
Keep watch over my life, for I am faithful.
Save your servant who puts his trust in you.
Be merciful to me, O Lord, for you are my God.
I call upon you all
gladden the soul of your servant.
For to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving.
And great is your love toward all who call upon you.
Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer.
And attend to the voice of my supplications.
In the time of my trouble, I will call upon you.
For you will answer me.
Among the gods, there is none like you, O Lord.
Nor anything like your works.
All nations you have made will come and worship you, O Lord.
And glorify your name.
For you are great, you do wondrous things.
And you alone are God.
Turn to me and have mercy upon me.
Give your strength to your servant and save the child of your handmaid.
Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be ashamed.
Because you, O Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Today's first lesson is from the book of Genesis. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bowshot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. The word of the Lord.
God. The canticle for today is on page 19 in the Book of Common Prayer. We are doing Canticle 14 today. Canticle 14, we're on page 19 in the Book of Common Prayer. We will say this in unison.
O Lord and ruler of the of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and of all their righteous offspring. You made the heavens and the earth with all their vast array. All things quake with fear at your presence. They tremble because of your power. But your merciful promise is beyond all measure. It surpasses all that our minds can fathom. O Lord, you are full of compassion, long-suffering, and abounding in mercy. You hold back your hand. You do not punish us as we deserve. In your great goodness, Lord, you have promised forgiveness to sinners, that they may repent of their sin and be saved. And now, Lord, I beg to heal my heart and make my appeal sure of your gracious goodness.
I have sinned, O Lord, I have sinned,
and I know my wickedness only too well. Therefore, I make this prayer to you. Forgive me, Lord, forgive me. Do not let me perish in my sin, nor condemn me to the depths of the earth. For you, O Lord, God of those who repent, and in me you will show forth your goodness. Unworthy as I am, you will save me in accordance with your great mercy. And I will praise you without ceasing all the days of my life. For all the powers of heaven sing your praises, and yours is the glory of ages of ages.
Amen. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
Today's second lesson is from the book of Romans. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who sin, who died to sin, go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in death like this, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our gradual hymn is number 488. The title of the hymn is Be Thou My Vision, number 488. Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said to the 12 disciples, "A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those in his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light. What you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father, and even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their lives will lose them, and those who lose their lives for my sake will find them." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Slaves, or all the stories about parenting. There's something, though, in the first and third lessons I want to bring to the forefront, and then a challenge to you at the end. So Hagar takes her son Ishmael and goes out into the desert because Sarah is jealous and fearful that she will have to split the inheritance of this long-awaited child, this miracle child. So Hagar is banished to the wilderness with her son, and nearing death, God intervenes. The point I want to make in that one, and just put this kind of, you know, a little flag in your head that we'll get back to this. God heard the cries of the child. That's the first one. The second thing that I want to make point of in the gospel lesson is Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. Because that's the way this is going to work. Not because it's easy, to quote John Kennedy, but because it's hard. And it is. Hard now. Hard for me, hard for you. It's a tough time. There's a lot of grief and a lot of pain. And with all that grief and pain are the folks that are stepping up to help as best they ought and can and will do. Fun little things like organizing a block party for kids, and the kids are on their hands and knees in their masks drawing on the sidewalk. Hopeful things with chalk. And then reveling in the fact that they had a creative moment together and a little bit of playtime. Even though there were masks and some social distance involved, there was some energy. Of restaurants who had to close their doors to patrons went out and looked for the patrons. And the number of places that have given food to food banks and to housing facilities and to hospitals and care facilities as well. So that these folks, when they go to work, there's food provided for them, and they don't have to think about that. And believe me, there's nothing like a nice meal in the middle of a 12-hour shift. A moment to breathe in and out. And not everything is code blue. That's a second piece of thing to think about. Take up your cross and follow me. There is a saying that nobody can absolutely pin down if the man said this or not. The man being in prison at the time that the Catholics and the Protestants were fighting over who should have precedent over the other's religion in England. So, you know, you start out with Edward, and then Edward dies, and Elizabeth becomes queen, but with that also Mary Queen of Scots, who was Catholic. It's kind of like watching Congress and who's in power. You know, one's got it, and the other one's feeling down, and then the other one has it, and these people are feeling down. Now, it's not just feel down, but they had a tendency to really take it out on each other. So, Bradford, as a Protestant, is in jail. And he watches a couple of guys being taken away in chains. And what's ascribed to him is the saying, "There but for the grace of God goes John Bradford." In other words, he's in jail, and that hasn't happened to him yet. That's been used in songs, it's been used in poetry. They take out Bradford's name and put your own in, or "there but for the grace of God go I." And you see that it's even used in the movies. "There but for the grace of God go I. There but for the grace of God goes John Bradford." That's all the history lesson you're going to get now. That's it. We're done. We're not done with the concept, however. Bradford eventually does die when the Catholics take over again, and he is indeed executed. And so, I won't say the grace of God failed him. I'll just say that's the way warring factions work. Who's on top? Who's winning? Who has the power? Who has the muscle? Back to Hagar and Ishmael. Hagar does not want to see her son die. So she puts him in the shade and moves away. And the boy's crying out for his mother and for sustenance and shelter. And those angels with the same story you've heard all your life. Don't be afraid. yeah. And the fact that it has to be in there over and over again in both the Old and New Testaments tell you that the idea of an angel is a fearful thing. But also a wonderful thing. They're usually making announcements. George Floyd was laying down on the ground with a knee cutting off his ability to breathe, and for his body to efficiently pump blood through his system. And he cried out to his mother, and he said, "I cannot breathe," and he died. Just like with Ishmael and Hagar, I think God had heard him. It's very humbling that he cried out for his mother. It's a thought-provoking thing. And a despairing and sad and wrenching thing. So the angels have taken to the streets and announcing enough is enough. Enough that some changes are coming because of the concern of the people in the streets. And for the most part, it's been pretty peaceable. But a community gathered is stronger than people locked behind their doors. I know we'll pay a price for some of these people ending up with COVID because of it. But so many of the young people said it's worth the risk. Their mamas don't think so. Their spouses don't think so. Maybe their siblings don't think so. But these are the folks that are picking up the cross and following. Just like the restaurateurs and the people who hand out chalk for children to draw on sidewalks. They understand the self-sacrifice that the time now demands of us. So I want to change the way we frame that Bradford supposed pseudo quote, "There but for the grace of God go I." How about "there because of grace go I"? That you and I will take action singularly and corporately to change the way that we are seeing one another. Love your neighbors yourself. I'd just like to sit down and talk to my neighbors. I miss Richard. I miss Donna and Brian. I miss Amy. Because we don't get to see each other because we're in separate homes right now. There must be some way to love your neighbor in the midst of all of this. There are more resources that will tell you what you might do, both in terms of your health and maintaining it, and you're offering to take up a cross and do something about the conditions in this country. Have you ever written to somebody in Congress? If not, maybe today's the day. Have you written a separate check other than to the church for any other outreach? And I know some of you do. Send money to the Pacifica Resource Center or some other community center that's helping those people who are unhoused and not covered by medical care. Have you ever made something to give away? A quilt, a blanket, a shawl, food? Maybe today's the day. Have you started calling people and saying we need to do something and maybe find yourself walking in one of the many, many, many marches in the Bay Area? Masks on, 6 feet apart. Except for your own family members. If you haven't gotten up and went to a march, maybe today is the day. Have you been in touch with your friends? Are you on with your family on Zoom or Skype or Meetup or any of the different things that are out there, even just a telephone call? Not. Today's the day. Have you written any thank you notes for the people that you can't see right now and you really, really, really miss them? Take the time for a handwritten note instead of an email. Maybe today is the day. Sacrifice is an important thing. It's something that Christianity has always said is part of the equation. Not like Paul in Romans today, and I just absolutely love that opening verse. Shall we sin so that grace abounds? You get the idea, right? The more you sin, the more God's grace has to come up to your level of sin to make it okay. So if you want more grace, you sin more. You get the picture? Shall we sin so that grace should abound? Heck no! You're not supposed to dwell on doing more sin. You're supposed to be freed from that. And he goes on and on. There because of God. There because of the grace of God. There because of the cross of Jesus, I will go. I'll put my feet to the path. My voice joining the multitudes. I will write, I will learn, I will read, and when it's most necessary, which is for me most of the time, I'll shut up. Because of the grace of God, there I go. And here we go. Not to sit idly by and just watch it on the news. There are lots of things to do. The first one is take care of yourself. Don't rush to somewhere you ought not go. Never go without a mask. Take care of yourselves. Exercise, diet, fluids. I use fluids now because it's really hot here in church. Talk to your friends. If you like what you see here, commend our services to your friends to share in a moment of stepping back and asking what God is doing in our lives now. Oh, and for the love of God, if you pray, pray more. Pray harder with intent. Pray for the LGBTQ community, for the DACA community, for all of those fathers and mothers who are worried about their sons and daughters leaving the house, for all who fear violence, for all of the stuff we've got going on still with migrants at the borders, with this COVID and all of the millions of people who are mourning their lost, those who have passed. And there, by the grace of God, go I. Take the challenge. If you get so inspired, drop us a note and tell us what you've done, especially if it's something you've never tried before, something new to you. Get creative.
I'm not creative.
Yes, you are. Don't use that as an excuse for not trying something new. Because God has heard the cry of Hagar's son in the desert. And God has heard George Floyd's cry in the streets of Minneapolis. And he hears the cries of the wives and children and mothers and fathers of these people. And there, because of the grace of God, we go. Amen. the service, Rudy is going to drop a piece of video for us. We've received permission from the church where this was done and by the musician who wrote the words. It takes about 4 minutes and 18 seconds to watch. So the title of the song that the solo guitarist is playing is called A Time for Silence. Ruby sent me the information and I immediately clicked on the link on Vimeo and watched. And it was every bit as wow as she said it was. So we thought that that would be a good thing for you to see and hear as well. So she made the efforts to contact the people involved, and we'll roll the credit as to exactly who wrote the music and who wrote the words. The artwork is spectacular, and I commend you to watching this, because there, because of God, we go.
There is a time for silence, a time to listen well, a time to hear the painful stories others have to tell. Oh God, may we who love to talk now hear the rage and fear, and may we learn from neighbors who have long been silenced here. There is a time for asking, a time to pause and pray. There is a time to hear the prophets speak of God's new day, to hear the words of Jesus, who taught welcome, truth, and love, to hear the Spirit speaking through the ones who shout, enough. There's time for humble study, for reading and for thought. God, may we learn from others of the justice they have sought, and may we learn from those who bravely stand against the hate. So when we're called to justice, we, your church, won't hesitate. There's time for good reflection, to ponder who we've been, to think how our own attitudes have paved the way for sin, to listen to the ones we fear, to folks we may resent, to hear of Jesus' call to love and humbly to repent. And there's a time to work now, to boldly say their names, to protest and to organize, to advocate for change, to use our voices and to stand with those who are oppressed. As we seek justice hand in hand, Lord, may your world be blessed. As we seek justice hand in hand, Lord, may your world be blessed.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us and heal us, O God.
For the ways the church has been complicit in enslaving others, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us and heal us, O God.
For those who have died from viruses, for those who have died at the hands of another, and for all who mourn them.
Hear us and heal us, O God.
For Errol Chang, Rayshard Brooks, Eric Garner, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Oscar Grant, Michael Brown, Ahmed Arbery, Stephen Clark, Tamir Rice, and others, may we remember their names and set ourselves the tasks of working for justice and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us and heal us, O God.
Please, in the Book of Common Prayer, turn to page 833 to recite together the prayers attributed to St. Francis of Assisi. That's in your Book of Common Prayer. Page number for that is 833. Lord,
Make us instruments of your peace.
Where there is hatred, let us sow love.
Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union.
Where there is doubt, faith.
Where there is despair, hope.
Where there is darkness, light.
Where there is sadness, joy.
Grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console,
to be understood as to understand,
to be loved as to love.
For it is in giving that we receive,
it is in pardoning that we are pardoned,
and it is in denying that we are born to eternal life.
And as Jesus has taught us, together we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The suffrages for today in the Book of Common Prayer on page 98. You'll see they're noted A and B. We will be reading responsibly suffrages B. Page 98 in the Book of Common Prayer. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance.
Govern and uphold them, now and always.
Day by day we bless you.
We praise your name forever.
Lord, keep us from all sin today.
Have mercy upon us, Lord. Have mercy.
Lord, show us your love and mercy.
For we put our trust in you.
And you, Lord, is our hope.
And we shall never hope in vain.
Let us pray. O Lord, make us have perpetual love and reverence for your holy name. For you never fail to help and govern those whom you have set upon the sure foundation of your loving kindness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. O God, whose light divides the day from the night and turns the shadow of death into morning, drive far from us all wrong desires, incline our hearts to keep your law, and guide our feet into the way of peace. That having done your will with cheerfulness during the day, we may, when night comes, rejoice to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who have brought us in safety to another new day, preserve us with your might and power, that we may not fall into sin nor be overcome by adversity. And in all we do, direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue saying in unison the General Thanksgivings Prayer. It's on page 101 in the Book of Common Prayer. Page 101. Almighty God,
Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us
and to
all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace, and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such awareness of your mercies, that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord,
to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen.
Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised for your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Time for announcements. Do not mistake me as an angel. I'm just here to make announcements. Thanks to Ruby for her work today in securing the appropriate permissions so that we can have that special video during our worship. And we'll make sure on the website to give you the contact so that you can watch it again at your leisure or forward it to friends, people that you think would value and find some solace and some thoughtfulness in sharing that. I think it's a great offering. We still don't know about the SBA loans, so I've called in the big guns. The diocese has given me somebody to work with, and he and I have an appointment tomorrow to go over the whole thing and resubmit, because the program stops on the 30th of June, so I have to have it finished pretty quickly. But I have help. We'll see what happens, you know? I mean, we just keep kicking the ball down the road, and then, you know, there because of the grace of God go I. Also, questions come up about when we're opening, and I do not have an opening date for you. The diocese has given the congregations both the requirement to explain what our get back into church plan would be, and if we plan not to get back anytime soon, that's an okay choice. We just need to let them know. So Dan and I are working out the last of it. We've started this discussion amongst some members of the BC, and we'll continue the discussion. But for the time being, we're going to continue the recorded services. And at some point in time, I may decide that to give the crew a day off in the summer, and I'll just sit at home and do a live stream for a Sunday morning, which I think would be kind of fun to do. So that's about all I have to tell you specifically. Continue for those who march, and for those who work for justice, including the people in our own community here. Continue to pray for the DACA kids. This is a reprieve, not a solution. Continue to pray for the LGBTQ people and their employers to work it out. And I think that's all I have at the moment. Except I miss you.
For those of you who don't know, there was a special meeting of Pacifica City Council. They called it a study session last night. And we're taping this on Thursday, so it was on Wednesday the 17th. This relates to the use of force policy in Pacifica. And this is very important because, like a lot of communities, Pacifica is looking at its policies and the way it uses police and trying to be up to date and appropriate and ethical in how it operates with things. Please do look up that meeting online and look at the things that were said, but more importantly, pay attention to what is going on with that, because this is not a one-time kind of thing. It's not like, okay, there was a problem, there was a few people who died, and there was a bunch of things in the street. No, this is part of the hard work that's involved in achieving justice, or at least working towards it. The chief of police was prominently featured in the meeting. He had his explanation of what their use of force policy is, and explained how it had changed over time. It's not clear to me whether that's going to be an adequate explanation. I doubt that the city of Pacifica and the people residents of Pacifica will agree to completely defund the police, but it is entirely possible that they might change the way police are used in this city. We all have a vested interest in making sure that we continue that work, so I urge you to pay attention to that. Any questions you have about that, you can call me or you can email me, and I'll attempt to answer that. And also do check out the City of Pacifica website. All these meetings are public, and you have a right, and I would say an obligation, to be informed. Thank you.
I think we call that civic duty.
Yes.
At least in my generation.
Yes, absolutely. And to me, I think that is something that's completely appropriate in a religious context. Mm-hmm. Because this is part of why we're gathering. It's not just so we can like make each other feel good, but it's what are we going to go out and do? What action are we going to take to promote justice in the world? Anyway, that's my sermon, sorry.
You got a twofer today, people. Following the blessing will be a song that's very well known. The words are going to be up on the screen because it isn't in most people's hymn books. There will be five verses, and it's called The Summons. And the opening line is, "Will you come and follow me if I but call your name?" But first, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
forth into the world, walking humbly with your God to do justice. And go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.